Hello, I'm Pam Tubbs.
I'm Ace Tubbs.
And welcome to our hymn sing-along for March the 21st, 2021. I will share my screen so that you'll be able to read along the music with us. Sharing now. And here we go from the beginning. You should be able to see our PowerPoint slide now. So our hymns, as I said, for this Sunday, the fifth Sunday of Lent, go along with the Revised Common Lectionary readings. That the music covers over 400 years from both sides of the Atlantic. And the lectionary readings from Jeremiah.
God says, I will make a new covenant, writing my law in your heart.
From Psalm 51.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a right spirit within me.
From Hebrews.
Jesus Christ, our high priest, is the source of eternal salvation.
And from John 12.
Jesus says, now I will be glorified. I will die and be lifted up.
The opening sentences for this Sunday. Through the season of Lent, O God, we have prayed for clean hearts and right spirits.
Forgive us, O Lord, if we have prayed with our words, but failed to pray with our actions.
Forgive us of what we have done that has contributed to the suffering of another.
And forgive us of what we have failed to do that could have lightened a neighbor's burden.
Blessed be the God of our salvation, who bears our burdens and forgives our sins.
Let us worship God in song.
Our first hymn is to Abraham and Sarah. And here's a stained glass window representation of Abraham and Sarah contemplating God's promise to make his descendants as numerous as the stars. Judith A. Pfeffer wrote this hymn in 1984, shortly before she and her pastor husband were called by the United Church of Canada to become missionaries to Brazil. The hymn condenses the Genesis 17 narrative and grounds it in the covenant relationship between God and his chosen people. The hymn is set to Llanfilin, a folk tune named for a village in Pembrokeshire, Wales. Let's sing to Abraham and Sarah. Is the motet Hide Not Thou Thy Face From Us, O Lord, composed in the 16th century by Richard Farrant. The words come from Psalm 27, 9 through 12. Farrant was a gentleman of the Chapel Royal, the title for an adult male singer of the British Royal Household Choir. They had some pretty fancy choir robes, yes. Here are a couple of views of the St. George's Chapel, Windsor interior. Farrant served as organist and choir master here for 12 years, during which time he directed music for the coronations of both Mary and Elizabeth I. Check out those decorated organ pipes. Woo. It was at St. George's that Farrant's music was first heard. Let's sing, Hide Not Thou Thy Face From Us, O Lord. This is meant to be sung a cappella, but you know, it's just us chickens, so I'll play the piano with us. Introduce our next hymn is a compelling portrait of Christ painted in 1906 by Czech artist Emanuel Dieter. At the Name of Jesus was written in 1861 by Caroline Maria Noel, the daughter of an aristocratic Church of England vicar. As a young woman, she was struck with a crippling illness that left her bedridden. She nevertheless produced a collection of poems intended for quote unquote, the sick and lonely. And it is one of those poems that are the lyric for this hymn. At the Name of Jesus was first paired with Ray Vaughan Williams's tune, King's Weston, in the 1925 Oxford Press hymnal, Songs of Praise. Let's sing. There are four verses at the Name of Jesus.
Every tongue confess.
Next up is What Wondrous Love Is This? A hymn some musicologists call the first white spiritual. Here we see one of the camp meetings of the Second Great Awakening, a Protestant religious revival during early 19th century America. To meet the spiritual needs of people who lived far from towns with church buildings, preachers went from state to state leading religious revivals at campsites. Preaching would go on for days, all day long and into the night. People would travel from many miles away for these events, staying overnight in tents. They sang hymns set to popular melodies of the time, like the Ballad of Captain Kidd, upon which the tune for What Wondrous Love was based. The hymn was first published in the 1835 shape note hymnal, Walker's Southern Harmony, in this three-part setting by Mr. Christopher. Its haunting melody helps convince us that the only adequate response to God's wondrous love is to sing on. Three different arrangements as we were singing through this, and this last verse with its open fifth chords, I think very reminiscent of the shape note style of singing. So that last verse was probably more characteristic of how it was originally sung. Next up, create in me a clean heart, O God. During his long life as a Presbyterian musician, Carl F. Mueller published over 500 works, of which Create in Me a Clean Heart is perhaps the best known. It is based on Psalm 51. After Nathan the prophet confronted King David about his adultery with Bathsheba and murder of Uriah, David ultimately felt the sting of his morally reprehensible behavior. He wrote the 51st Psalm as a poetic lament for his disgrace. It is a particularly fitting anthem for Lent, when we contemplate our sin and recognize our need for forgiveness. We also count on the uplifting hand of God to heal us, restore us, and create within us a new heart. This is, the melody line goes a little high in this piece, and so I'll be singing the alto line. Those who are singing the melody, soprano, please listen to the piano. Don't be thrown off by my alto. And also, when we get to the last chord, everybody imagine that we can hear the tenors singing the Picardy third on that last chord. Here we go. Here's a bit of manuscript in the hand of Handel, haha, to introduce another treatment of Psalm 51, this one by George Friedrich Handel. In 1748, Handel wrote a collection of sacred songs that came to be known as the Shandos Anthems, named for his patron at the time, James Bridges, the first Duke of Shandos, who, by the way, was the great-great-uncle of Jane Austen. We'll be singing the third motet from this collection, Keep Me Faithfully. This arrangement is a bit challenging for me to read both the vocal line and the piano part while singing, but I believe you all will be able to sing this lovely anthem with us without too much difficulty. Plus, we'll go slowly. Let's sing Keep Me Faithfully.
Thank you.
to conclude this evening's hymn sing-along, we have, "There is a place of quiet rest," otherwise known as "Near to the Heart of God." Composer Cleland Boyd McAfee was a Presbyterian pastor from Missouri who trained at Union Theological Seminary in New York City. He served congregations in Brooklyn and Chicago as pastor and choir director, and later became a professor at McCormick Theological Seminary in Chicago. In 1929, he was moderator of the General Assembly of the Presbyterian Church in the U.S. McAfee's hymn was born of tragic circumstances. In 1903, two of his young nieces, a baby and a toddler, died of diphtheria. The family and town were stricken with grief. Surely there are many families these days who understand this kind of loss. McAfee was moved to write this hymn, and after the choir learned it in one rehearsal, they went to his brother's home and sang it outside the darkened, quarantined house. The hymn's unpretentious language paints a vivid picture of a place where we can meet God face to face. The refrain finds its musical apex on the word Jesus, invoking our Redeemer to hold us near to the heart of God. Would you join us in closing prayers? Holy God, by the cross and resurrection of Jesus, you lift the suffering world toward hope and transformation.
Lord, do not remember our sins, but forgive our iniquities.
We pray for the cleansing of our hearts, secure in the knowledge that Jesus Christ our Lord is the source of eternal salvation.
May we rest in peace this night, and awake refreshed to greet the newness of your day to come.
Sisters and brothers, let us pray for the world and its needs. O Lord, hear now our prayers, especially for and for all those needs and cares unspoken, but known by you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And God be with you till we meet again. Good night.
Good night.